So thank you all for coming, and thanks to CogDev to give me the opportunity to talk tonight. So I'll start this presentation by first briefly introducing myself to give you an idea of where I'm coming from and what kind of problem technology I'm going to talk about tonight solve for us. So I've started working in a company in Cork called Pills about a bit over 2 years ago now, and what they do, they provide industrial control and automation solutions to various customers around the globe. And the team I joined with was a visualization team trying to create a new tool to allow customers in different industries to create their own visualization applications to see the state of their automation control system. So to do that, we decided to go with web technologies, because it will allow them to create their custom visualization application and style them very easily and so on. So that worked quite well for us, except when we target some of the embedded devices that some Pill customers were using, where it's on those platforms it's very hard to get a browser to compile, and once you eventually get it to compile on those embedded platforms, the performance is just not good enough. So the alternative at that stage was to re-implement our visualization engine natively in C++ using the Windows API, which would be a world of pain, and we definitely didn't want to do that. So about 2 years ago, we looked for a better solution, and we came across Qt and the stuff I'll talk about tonight. And that really sped up the development of our solution on that embedded platform. And later we found as well that we have a separate team starting to look at cross-platform mobile application development, and they're currently evaluating Qt as well because it's addressed this issue as well. So we have two teams working a bit with that technology in Pills. So the talk tonight is about cross-platform application development with QML and JavaScript. So my objective really today is to present the Qt library, more specifically with QML and JavaScript, as a good solution to develop cross-platform applications that will run off desktop, mobile, and embedded platforms. So Qt is a library that facilitates the development of cross-platform application initially in C++. So writing cross-platform application in C++ is quite complex because you have to deal with all the different operating system APIs in your code, and it's very different if you're on Linux or Windows, for example. So Qt solves that problem by abstracting all the operating system specific details in their own libraries so that you can focus on the logic of your application that matters. And then once you're done writing it, you can compile and deploy on many applications, being same application will run on desktop, mobile, and embedded platforms. So the library itself is 20 years old. So they've been around for a while. I think that they basically solve the issue of cross-platform development in C++, at least for the desktop, and now they're trying to innovate to ease the development of similar applications in on the mobile and embedded platforms with technologies such as QML, JavaScript, I'll talk about in the talk. They are doing a good job at it. So the library itself offers a lot of functionality. So it comes up with some development tools. It has a lot of classes and APIs to develop user interfaces, data storage, multimedia, networking, connectivity, trading as well, concurrency, graphics. It makes it very easy to integrate some web content. Also have a good support for mobile APIs, so all the sensors you have in your phones, they offer a cross-platform way to deal with them. You can create QML applications that we'll talk a lot tonight. They have good support for scripting and internationalization. It comes with a good few testing and debugging tools also. So tonight, however, I just want to focus on the different ways you could create user interfaces in Qt, and more specifically on Qt Quick, which is that new innovative way that they came up with. So one way to create user interfaces in C++ is to use Qt widgets in the library. So Qt widgets are the traditional ways to develop GUIs on the desktop in C++. It's very a similar concept that you have in in Mesio programming language. For example, if you've done a bit of .NET before, you have your form designer when you can preview your window and you can drag and drop some elements in it or widgets. You set up properties, you can add code to handle various events such as user click on a button and so on. And with that, you can create your GUI applications on the .NET platform, for example. So Qt widgets are basically the same thing for C++ applications in Qt. So Qt widgets will give you a native look and feel that will look native on its target platform. So if you create one application and you deploy it on Windows or Linux, they will look a bit different, but they will look like a native Windows application or a native Linux application as well. So you have a bunch of standard entry widgets, and you have some ModelView frameworks or APIs that let you being quite productive as it implements some common patterns in UI development. However, it's really hard to get a custom look and feel that completely deviates from the traditional desktop GUIs. There is no hardware acceleration, but there is no need to really, because they don't support animations or fancy graphical effects as you could have with CSS3, for example. Another way to you could create user interfaces in Qt, especially if you're a web developer, is to use two modules, either Qt WebKit or Qt WebEngines. Those two modules essentially let you integrate some web content within your applications, and so that you could develop everything using web technologies, HTML5, JavaScript, CSS, and then deploy to many platforms that are supported by Qt. So if you're into mobile development, for example, a lot of people do that already with stuff like PhoneGap, and you could do the same thing with those modules in Qt. So the Qt WebKit is the original component for that, that embeds the WebKit browser into it and use it to render it. And the Qt WebEngine is the latest addition to it. It's the same thing, except that it uses a Chromium embedded framework to render your web content. So Chromium is the open source version of Google Chrome, and originally it was using WebKit, but over time they just modified it a bit, changed it and so on, and those are quite different. So Qt wants to keep using the web engine in the future to support web content rendering. So whatever you render within your Qt application should look the same as what you render in Chromium or Google Chrome. That's the idea behind it. So using those web content containers are very good if you're already a web designer with web development skills. You'll get up and running very quickly. You'll get a single look and feel across all your applications, which, as in any web app, it may or may not be a good thing depending on your requirements. That's what you get. And if you already have some web content, it's a very easy way to package it within an applications. And also, a good thing about it is they provide C++, JavaScript, and QML APIs in the Qt framework, so that it's very easy to communicate from your web application in JavaScript to some backend code written in C++ or QML within Qt. So it's quite a comprehensive solution that way. We have more and more requirements to get applications that have truly custom look and feel, like more and more like a web application. So for example, if we wanted to create something like that with maybe graphs, animation, some kind of effects, not necessarily medical applications, could be anything, you can't really do that with the traditional Qt widgets in C++. You could obviously do that using web technologies as web applications, and many people do. It's a great solution, especially if you're skilled in that, but if you've never done web programming before, it could take you a while to ramp up to the stack and get productive with it. And another issue, as we had in Pills, was that on some truly embedded platforms, it's a waste of resources to try to run something within a browser. And some of similar applications could be running on a car dashboard or something like that. So the team behind Qt came with a new technology, Qt Quick, that will try to get the best of both worlds. So the Qt Quick technology was developed with mobile platform in mind. in mind. It's optimized for touch screens. It's to create a truly custom look and so user interfaces with truly custom look and feel. It's two of the its strong points is when you want to deal with fluid and animated user interfaces. It can go with animations up to 60 frame per second. You have loads of fancy graphical effects like animations, particles, sprites. Some of it you could do in CSS3, but it's much more efficient because all your views are rendered using an OpenGL scene graph, so it will use optimizations as part of your processor or GPU, if you have one. So Qt Quick was created really for rapid UI development. It uses QML and JavaScript. So QML is a programming language that was developed as part of Qt Quick and for Qt Quick in Qt. So you could just use QML and JavaScript, but if you want to, you could add C++ to model your logic, but you don't have to. And the whole idea with Qt Quick is to let you create declarative user interfaces with property bindings. And these are two very nice properties that will become a bit more apparent when we look at actual code. So the QML language itself was created as part of Qt Quick. So QML is a declarative language that's designed to describe the user interface of a program, both what it looks like and how it behaves. So in QML, a user interface is specified as a tree of objects with property. Now I want to show you a few features of the QML language or QML syntax to see what it looks like, and then we'll go through a few code examples as well. So here, let's imagine we want to draw a rectangle of our square 200 by 200 pixels with a light gray background color and display an image centered within it. So the description here is we have our tree of objects. The root object is a rectangle with property, width, height, and color. Then we have a child object, an image, which has a source and anchor that center in property. And this will link to its parent, which will be the rectangle here. So that's what QML looks like. In QML, you can use expressions and property bindings. So for example, here we have, again, an item with a rectangle within it. The item width and height properties are defined using two expressions. So those expressions will be evaluated, and the result of those evaluations will be assigned to the properties width and height. Now, it gets interesting in the rectangle itself because the width is defined as an expression as well, but the expression contains a property binding, so the width of the parent. So the width will be the same as its parents, minus 50 pixels. But because it's declarative and with property bindings, if the width of the item was to change because you resize your window or you set it explicitly, the width of the child of the parent will update itself so that that expression is always true. So you can see, oh, with that the way of doing things, it's you save a lot. You have a much more succinct code. You save a lot because you don't have to worry of how you're going to transition from one state to another. You just describe the states you want, and you'll get there eventually, because all this will be interpreted in C++ for you in the backend. Last small feature of the language I want to talk about are how to handle signals and user events with your program. So here we have an item of 100 by 100 pixels again. So an item in QML is high-level component, a bit like a div, a DOM nodes in HTML. And here we have a mouse area that would fill that that component as well. So a mouse area is like an invisible layer you'll put on a component and lets you deal with user actions, user events. So here we have click properly, so it's an event handler for that components. And here we have inlined JavaScript code. And so when the user click on that component, it just print a message to the console. And a nice thing as well, if you're a JavaScript developer, the API to print to the console and many parts of the framework is the same as you'll find in the browser or in JavaScript in general. So Now I just want to show you three different examples that will, you know, to give you a bit of an idea what you can do with that stuff, and then we look a bit in the code to see what it looks like and how much code is involved and so on. So the first example we look at is a game called The Same Game. So it's basically a puzzle game with a bunch of squares of different colors, and the idea, the objective is to clear out the screen as quickly as possible. So when you press, let's say if I press on the blue square here, all the blue square will that touches it will disappear, and so on. So basic puzzle game. So I'll show you all these examples within an IDE called Qt Creator that comes with Qt. A good thing about Qt itself is that it comes with many code examples to demonstrate various features of the library, and they also come with documentations and a bunch of video tutorials about many features of the library. So you can find all that online as well, but it's quite handy to have all that in your IDE. So we'll look at that same game quickly. Oh yeah, and every time you start an example or a tutorial program, you have a small description telling you why they created that example. So here they want to demonstrate a QML game with custom types and some logic written in JavaScript. The game uses various Qt features such as particles, animations, and loading images. And all this is done quite effectively because it's all rendered by OpenGL. So, and if we look again at the source codes in that file, we have one C++ file, which is basically empty, just has a macro to load the main QML file. And everything else is just images, QML files, and one JavaScript file. So here is a game. I will just do a puzzle to demonstrate. So I want to clear in three moves. So you can see the particles, effects, and okay, I failed here. I'll try again. Blue first, yeah. And I'll clear in 10 seconds. You can see it's quite fluid. I don't have the task manager here, but it's low resources as well. So that's basically what I wanted to show for that example. The next one is a tweet search. It's an example that will, it's a thin wrapper around the Twitter API, and it will allow you to search for tweets, for recent tweets by word, username, or hashtags. So here, what they want to show us with that example is how you could do request authentication when you're talking to remote APIs, how to do those AJAX requests, and how to pass the results in a JSON format. So here, as I say, we could search by word, by user, by hashtags. We'll search by work. We'll have a look at, is anybody talking about Cork Dev on Twitter? No, the connection goes through my phone, so it's a bit slow. So we have the list of tweets here coming up. And if there are links and I click on it, it just opens them into my default web browser. Yeah, so we close that. So if we look, a bit at the QML code inside, so I close that view here. So the tweet search, again, it's only QML and JavaScript. There is no C++ in it, except that main file that's quite empty. So let's have a look at the main QML files. So as you can see here, you have some import statement, and then you have a rectangle QML components with a bunch of properties. And if you scroll down a bit, here you have a JavaScript function. So it's regular JavaScript syntax that you can use. So here it uses an IDE, which is a model. and we can search through them and so on. So what I want to look at here is the tweets model. So the tweets model is not a built-in it's not a built-in QML component. It's a custom type we've created here in that project, and it's used to keep a collection of tweets that was fetched from the server, and that custom type or element will be defined in its own tweetmodel.qml file. And if we open it here, we can see that we are mixing again. It's a QML item here with properties, and what that QML item will do, it will have a list model, which is some kind of QML components to store the tweets, and it has a bunch of JavaScript code. The one here I'm going to do to show you is a function that will do your AJAX call to your Twitter API. So it's using the XML HTTP request as you would in plain JavaScript in the browser. And when the data come back, you could parse that data and append it to your collection of tweets. And then the views will take it from there. So the last example I want to talk about is a stock Qt. It's the same idea that you have behind the tweets, but this one will let you do a bit of filtering in the data and render it as a graph as well. So all the data will be pulled from Yahoo Finance. So let's open it again. And run it. Again, it's a bit slow, it's on the phone. So here we can see the Apple stock. We can filter what kind of data we want to see. We can view it by monthly, weekly data, or as much as we can. And if we go here, on the left, we have our list of stocks, and we will just pick one and have a look at it. And again, can do the same functionality. So if we look at the QML, the code for that one, again, there is no C++, only the main file. And here we have only QML files. There is no JavaScript file, but the JavaScript is embedded in various places within the file. So here we have our tree of QML components. We have a rectangle, another one here, items, text, a list view, a stock model, and so on. I want to look a bit at the stock model. So it's the model that will store the various stock data that we pull from the API. So that component, it's again a custom type we created and that will be defined as in on file somewhere else, has a bunch of properties. Some properties are stock ID or stock name, but here we have a property that does an event handling. So there is a very nice convention used in QML. If you do on property name change, you will be able to handle any event that could happen for whenever that property changes. So it makes it very nice to work with as well. And then it will call the update stock to the stock object. So here, the stock is itself, so it will call the update stock defined in its component definition file, which will be the here. We'll have a look in a second. And here below, we have a second a built-in event handler that which will just execute inline JavaScript statements. So here we'll look at how that function is defined. So the update stock function is defined within the stock model itself. It's just a plain JavaScript function which is scoped. If we go up a bit here, that function and the other ones are scoped within the stock model QML element. So the stock model QML element is a list model, again, that will store a list of all the stock data, and it has functions that, as you would on objects in other programming languages. And here we have a request URL, index of, or what. And here we have functions again. The update stock will be another one that will do an AJAX request, a get onto the API, and we'll retrieve the data, parse it, and add it to our model. So that's how we organize it as well. And if, for example, you look at here and say, OK, we've came across the list model a few times, I'd like to know a bit more about it. You just press F1. You have the help coming up with the API descriptions, detailed description, and then example as well. And if there is something else in the example you want to learn a bit about, you just click, you go through the definition, and then it tells you a bit more about it. So I want to show you just a last small feature of that program. If we look at the stock view, so somewhere we the stock view, which what is used to render that main view here, and it's mainly divided in three parts. We have so in the stock view is at the white square here. So we have the stock description, stock info, stock settings, and we have the chart itself. So that description of the user interface maps quite well to its definition in QML. So you have a rectangle, a main rectangle containing the data, and with inside you have a stock info that's in the top left of your UI. Then you have the top chart that will be at the bottom right, or to the right. And then you have your stock settings panel, which will be at your bottom left of your UI as well. And all these three elements will be custom QML types or custom QML components that are all defined in their own QML files. So if we look at the stock chart here, for example, oops, wrong key, it's F2. The stock chart, again, it's a rectangle with a lot of properties, a bit of JavaScript functions in it, and it has a few buttons and a bit of text, so it's all to let you filter what data you want to look at. And then the main bit is QML Canvas, which uses a very similar API to the Canvas in the browser in the JavaScript HTML. So you have properties for your Canvas QML element, and then you can have a lot of, well, not that much, but JavaScript file to deal with the graph. So those functions you'll have here is a typical function you will have in your charts or plotting libraries in JavaScript. So that's basically it. And one aspect of that particular example is that they redefine their own elements for a button. Like, it's quite simple, but they redo it themselves, and a checkbox. So all those three examples that I showed you will look exactly the same on whatever platform you want to deploy onto. And in that last one, they were recreating their buttons, their checkbox, which is a bit overkill. Since that example was made, there is a new package that came up with it called Qt Quick Control. And this is basically doing the C++ based Q widgets for QML. So the whole idea here, we have the same QML user interface using ready-made controls for us. And here is a program deployed on OS X. And here we have the same program deployed on the Android platform phone. So if we have the tab selector here, for example, will be at the bottom with a different look and feel here. And the layout is more or less the same, and the elements themselves are a bit different. So that if the stock examples was redone using Qt Quick Controls, it could be a good bit shorter even and quicker to implement as well. So what I'm trying to do here in that slide is give you an example of the amount of code or the complexity of those three elements. So here I'm measuring a physical line of code, so it includes comments, blank lines, and so on. So it's a very rough measure of the amount of code in it. So those numbers could be artificially quite high as well. But one thing that struck me when I look at that is that the same game, which is the game that's by far the most complex example, is only roughly twice the amount of code than the tweet search, which is a fairly basic one. So the stock Qt here is a bit more complex, mainly because of the plotting and the graphings, and they didn't reuse any libraries for that. But what's interesting as well, for example, is the stock games will have much more JavaScript comparatively than the tweet search, because again, the logic and the complexity of application is much larger, and you just express that in JavaScript. And it's a very hard comparison, but I just wanted to try to get a reference point as well, so I included the number of lines of code for the to-do MVC applications. So if you don't know it, to-do MVC is an application that's been implemented using many JavaScript framework in order to let you choose, as a developer, see what framework is best, what you prefer, and how they do things. And in that graph, I try to compare number of lines of code for the to-do MVC applications written in a pure JavaScript without any other framework. And the results, well, as you can see, it's a lot of JavaScript because it's a JavaScript example. I will rate the complexity of that application somewhere between those two, between the Twitter and the StockQt. I'm not trying to compare the two technologies here, but it just try to get an idea of how much code is involved. And if you look at it, the same gain is a bit more than to-do MVC. It's quite impressive, but if you look, to-do MVC, tweet search, is not that low. It's just a reference point, just to get an idea of it. So I hope by now you have a better idea of what Qt and QML, Qt Quick could do for you. I think it could be great if you're involved in game development, or it's definitely an option if you want to look at mobile app, cross-platform mobile app developments. And again, if you're, as we saw last month with Dave, like a web developer looking as a quick way to do a small desktop applications, it could be a very good way to do it as well, potentially very quick to pick up and efficient. So thank you for listening, and let me know if you have any questions.
What are the test tools like?
So the test tools. So if you're doing in C++, you have all the C++ testing profiling tools you want, but in QML, you have a QML profilers, similar to what you'll find in the Chrome tools, when you can see timelines of your UI threads, the rendering, the parsing, the QML files, and the JavaScript execution, because it embeds the V8 as well, and you can monitor that. So that's one way. You can debug and step through the code. You can put breakpoints in your C++ code if you have some, or the QML JavaScript code as well. So you could step through your code, QML JavaScript. And you have a unit test framework, which really apply for C++ development as well. And yeah, that's mainly it. It's debugging and the profiler for QML. And the cool thing as well is if you have a compiled applications, you could embed your QML file in resources, but you could just deploy them next to your application as well. So you could update your QML files without having to recompile your application. Sorry.
Is it a proprietary framework or is it open source?
No, there is a lot of confusion about it because it was created, I think, by Nokia first, and then it went through a couple of companies. So it's an open source framework, but it's built and managed by now the Qt company. And so, for example, it's used for the KDE desktop system on Unix. And there was a lot of, over the years, you see, oh, is Qt free? Do you have to pay for it? And so on. So it's free and open source. The only thing is, if you modify the code in any way, you will have to share the modification you did to Qt. You don't have to share your code at all, but just modification you did to the framework. And if you're compiling in C++, with the open source version, you're only allowed to build a dynamic library. So it means you have to bundle the Qt binaries with your files. But if you deploy to Android, it does, or iOS, it doesn't matter. They just bundle up everything. And the latest, yes, that's the main thing. And if you buy a license, you could get support from the Qt company. But you could definitely use it as in the open source version.
You might have covered it already, but is the JavaScript runtime, are they using the operating system's JavaScript runtime, or is this
no,
they embed their own?
They embed the V8 runtime. And when we are trying, for example, to go compile a browser on our embedded system, it's compiling the browser itself, but it's easier with Qt. And so it's a JavaScript runtime. It's nearly fully feature JavaScript you can do. The main thing is that you have no global object. So if you you have no window object and you have no global object. So because of that, sometimes it's hard to import some JavaScript libraries. But for I've seen blog posts of people doing to-do applications in QML using Backbone, a slightly modified version of Backbone underscore and Zepto in order to do their things. They couldn't use jQuery because it refers to the DOM so much. But there are ways to include some, as long as you don't mess or touch with the global object and forget your var keyword in some of your things, you're good.
Is it very difficult to communicate back and forth between C++ and it if you were doing that kind of thing?
No. When we use it at work, it's a fair bit of C++ because we just want as much performance we can get on those embedded platforms. But the way they do it in C++ events, they have that idea of signals and signals on slots. So you have you could define your objects to have like events that could trigger events and they could receive some type of events, and then you connect them at runtime. So it's fairly decoupled in that way. So using the signals or the event system, you could seamlessly send or listen to some events between the QML and the Java and the C++. I haven't used the JavaScript API in the Qt WebKit modules, but as far as I understand, it's based on WebSocket, similar to WebSocket communications, and they'll have their own protocol in the URI. It would be QTC or something like that, and they have a message passing APIs between the two. And it's, again, if you do in QML and JavaScript, it's very easy, just calling a function or modifying objects directly. And if you call interface with C++ code, you could pass signals on slots, so events between the two, but you could also directly call functions or methods between the two, update properties directly as well.
In QML, when you're specifying pixels, is it also possible to specify device or density and pixels?
No. You have macros about some devices or platforms. I haven't used them much. What you can do, you can device. Yes, you can. You can have macros in your code to look at the Qt version, because you could have the same code for Qt version 4 or 5, and version 4 will have less features than in 5, for example. So you might have different implementations. So usually, if you have target devices, like it's very rare that we'll do a program that will work on many platforms. It will work on many platforms, but your user experience won't be good. So you tend to, maybe you could have different QML files for the view to how to handle your some elements. Maybe you show more on a tablet than you would on a phone, for example. So you could test for the size. You could test for the target platform. Device, I'm not sure it's related to the platforms. You could test for the size of the screen. And you could have access to the orientation of the screen as well, of your device. And you can also, you have some loader components. So let's say if you have five different QML views for your applications, you could have a loader component that tell you which view to use with a bit of a JavaScript in a JavaScript function. So you could combine whatever macros or parameters you want into that. And yeah, if I want to add the last thing, what I really like about it is it's a language that you could have a designer pick up fairly quickly. And if you have a C++ backend or somebody else working on your model bit, your model doesn't know a thing about your UI. It just describes what the data looks like, and the UI defines what bits of the data it wants to grab or to use. And then it just works like that, and it's a pleasant way to work, I find.
Any more questions?
Is there much overheads if you download a binary?
So it comes in C++. Well, when you deploy that, you'll have the Qt binaries, like the DLLs, coming with it. So I mainly work on an embedded platform, so it get 3-4 DLL, so it could be a few megs each. I'm not sure of the size. But the performance is quite good. Like what we're mainly working with is embedded platform and Qt4, so it's QML, but you wouldn't have the OpenGL sync graph behind, so it's all rendering with the CPU. But it's quite good. Like in some use case when we were updating the interfaces in many places at the same time quite often, it was performing better than the widgets, for example, in pure C++, because they do optimization of how to talk to the UI thread and so on. And when we were comparing our web-based solution as opposed to that stuff, again, it was our extreme use case when we were updating hundreds of elements every 200 milliseconds. The Qt will take maybe 17 megs in memory and could do 7 or 8 times more than the HTML solutions that will take 100 megs in memory and max out the processor as well. So for us, for resource constraint, it was really good to do. And so there's a bit of overhead, but not that much.
Yeah,